Buster that I ain't a fan of Custer's, and the general, he don't ride well anymore. To some he was a hero, but to me his score was zero, and the general, he don't ride well anymore.
I remember a conversation from almost 35 years ago when the church members were giving us a pounding. A pounding is an old-fashioned tradition celebrated in rural churches where a new pastor is welcomed to the church with gifts of food. This custom provides a new pastor's family with a pound of various staples, such as a pound of flour, a pound of sugar, a pound of butter, etc. In our case, the pounding took place on a Sunday night after the evening worship service in the fellowship hall. One of the church members said to me that night, "Brother Stan, what are your hobbies?" To which I had no answer, because I didn't really have any hobbies at the time. He then went on to tell me about all of the hobbies that he enjoyed, including stamp collecting, model cars, wood burning, and calligraphy, just to name a few. Whenever a person asks me that question now, I will usually say that I enjoy reading books about Custer and the Battle of the Little Bighorn, which inevitably leads to another question. Why do you like to read books about Custer and the Battle of the Little Bighorn? And the answer is simple, because this story contains so many different aspects from which we can learn about life. There's mystery, love, beauty, hatred, jealousy, pride, ambition, arrogance, war, military strategy and tactics, culture, and a clash between two opposing cultures, politics, propaganda, journalism, history, geography, animals, various tribes of Native Americans, along with their traditions and ceremonies, manifest destiny, the superiority complex of European Americans at the time, and so much more. And thus the reason so many books have been written about Custer and the Battle of the Little Bighorn, and continue to be written 146 years after this fateful event occurred in American history. We tend to forget that the Battle of the Little Bighorn shocked the nation, in much the same way that Pearl Harbor and 9/11 affected succeeding generations. All across the country, Americans were celebrating our nation's centennial on July the 4th, 1876, as news of Custer's demise spread across the land. One of the most interesting things to me about Little Bighorn is that no one really knows what happened exactly. So there are a plethora of theories and opinions about the battle. For example, did Custer's hunger for glory cloud his capacity to effectively plan his attack on the Indian village, as his antagonist proclaimed? Or was he a military genius whose battle strategy would have succeeded if Major Reno had continued his charge into the camp as Custer had ordered him to do, which is the narrative that Custer's wife, Libby, promoted for the rest of her life in efforts to make her late husband into a national hero? For sure, Libby Custer, who died in 1933, would have absolutely hated Johnny Cash's song about her husband, because in her opinion, he always rode tall in the saddle. Or, as another theory surmises, was Custer severely wounded early on in the battle while crossing the river, and therefore any suggestion of a valiant last stand is nothing but a myth? The truth of the matter is that no one really knows, and thus it remains somewhat of a mystery, which makes this historical event all the more interesting to study and reflect upon, in my opinion, at least. Books about the Little Bighorn tend to be either pro or con in their views about Custer. Authors who write about this battle rarely present a middle-of-the-road or unbiased perspective on General George Armstrong Custer, who was, in fact, considered a hero of the Civil War. The table used for the signing of the documents that ended the Civil War was presented to Libby by General Sheridan, who later wrote her a note saying that there is scarcely an individual in our service who has contributed more to bring about this desirable result than your very gallant husband. Libby lent the table to the National Museum in 1912, and then, according to the terms of her will, the loan became a bequest after her death, and the table has remained in the National Collections ever since. But I digress. The point I am trying to make is simply this. Most people tend to either love or hate Custer, which in a strange way seems to be a factor in one's popularity, as is the case for performers like Bob Dylan, or in the notoriety game by politicians like Donald Trump, who most people either love or hate, with no room for middle ground. This love or hate quality about Custer, along with all the mystery surrounding the battle, all combine to keep this story alive and even relevant as we apply different elements of the narrative to current day events. Hopefully, we can learn from this history and not repeat it. But as we all know, one of the truisms of history is that, unfortunately, it often repeats itself. One author titled his book about Little Bighorn, A Terrible Glory. And what a great description for this battle, because it was a glorious day for the Indians in their defeat of Custer and the 7th Cavalry. But it was a terrible glory, because it became, in some respects, the beginning of the end for the Native Americans, as the tragedy at Wounded Knee 14 years later proved. It was a terrible day for Custer, because he and all of his men died in the battle. But it was also a glorious day for Custer, since people are still writing and reading books about him all these years later. Thanks for listening, my friend, and whatever views you hold about Custer, remember this. It is all too easy to judge the actions of people in the past. But if we do this, we must also remember that future generations will one day look back and judge us as well. And we have no idea about which of our actions they might find offensive. We might think that we are riding tall in the saddle on our moral high horse. But as Johnny Cash and Steve Earle sing about Custer, 100 years from now, people might think that we don't ride so well anymore, and they may pound on us in the same way that people pound on Custer today.
General, he don't ride.